right, everyone. I'm very excited to introduce the lovely Greg to you this afternoon. I'm over at the US Mint. I've been wanting to hear about these coins. I know some of you have requested it. Greg, you have a really important job, and I can't remember what it is.
I am senior legal counsel at the United States Mint. I work in Washington, D.C., but we represent all the Mints. Philadelphia, Denver, West Point, San Francisco, and the folks at Fort Knox.
Which one's your favorite?
Oh, they're all my favorite.
Good answer.
You can't choose one child.
Exactly. Now, these coins have been a big draw card to visitors coming over to the US Mint.
Mm-hmm.
Why are they so popular?
These are very interesting pieces. There are three coins. Really, it's two coins and one. Two very distinct stories, and yet the commonality is they are all coins that should not exist, and they are coins that left the U.S. Mint through surreptitious means.
Right.
So they are stolen coins that came back into the possession of the Mint. Which one would you like to start with? The Double Eagles or the...
The Double Eagles, please.
Absolutely. Well, this is a good story. It may make a good movie someday. So back before 1933, we made gold coins at the U.S. Mint, just like we made silver coins in dollars, halves, quarters, and dimes. We made gold coins, a $20 gold coin and a $10 gold coin. The $10 gold coin had an eagle on the back, and so it was known as an eagle. This, being twice the value of that, is a double eagle. And it's a beautiful coin. It's designed by Augustus St. Gaudens.
Mm-hmm.
And we made them all the way up through 1932. In 1933, however, President Roosevelt came into office, and one of his first acts as president was to ban the private ownership of gold. That was because back then, the dollar was on the gold standard. People were shipping gold out of the United States because they were having more economic troubles in Europe than even we were in the United States, and there was a genuine concern that the dollar could destabilize.
Right.
And so people had to turn in their gold coins and receive paper bills in return.
Do most people do this?
Yes, it sounds like something that's a little crazy, but actually it was a very patriotic thing to do.
Right.
And
people were happy to do it.
People turned in their coins, and all these coins came in. They were melted down into gold bars, and that's why we have Fort Knox today. Now, meanwhile, the Philadelphia Mint, they're a money factory, and they certainly got the message that they were to no longer pay out gold coins.
Okay.
But they started manufacturing the 1933 coins anyway, because who knew how long this order was going to be in effect.
1933 is a great year for coins everywhere all over the world. There's always a little story about 1933.
It is. So they manufactured about 450,000 of the 1933 dated double eagles. But they were all stored away until they heard something from Washington about how to proceed.
Okay.
Finally, by 1934, the order came down, melt them all down. These coins are never going to be issued.
Right.
And so they did. All the 1933 double eagles went into the melting pot, except for two that were sent to the Smithsonian as part of the National Numismatic Collection.
Oh, that's fair. Yes.
And so that should have been the end of the story. And it was until 1944 when 1933 double eagles started showing up. And a New York City newspaper called the Mint and said,
hold on a minute.
How many 33s were issued? And the Treasury Department responded, none. They were all melted down. They said, well, would you be surprised to see one for auction up in New York? The Treasury Department said, yes, we would. And they contacted the Secret Service, presuming, of course, that it must be a counterfeit. The Secret Service confiscated the one coin that was for sale in New York, compared it against the two in the Smithsonian, and lo and behold,
it's the real deal.
They were struck with the same gun. That commenced a fairly elaborate and detailed investigation where they discovered a theft.
What a caper.
That, in fact, the cashier at the Mint, a gentleman named George McCann, who was already in some trouble for some other shenanigans, had, in fact, smuggled out an undisclosed number of 1933 double eagles and utilized a jeweler in Philadelphia, a gentleman named Israel Swift, to help distribute them to collectors who were interested in them.
Now, you say smuggle out. Did he do this all in one batch? He must have done it a little bit at a time.
We don't know the mechanics of it.
Okay.
What we do know is that he had access to a bag of 25 of them because of something called the Asset Commission. Back in those days, the way you did quality control was you took coins from each of the various presses, you put them into a then known as the PIX box.
Okay.
And every year the Asset Commission would come together and they tear them up and make sure they are what they said they are.
Right.
So in preparation for the 1933 assay, he had 25 in his office.
Right.
The presumption is that he swapped out into the melting pot 25 previously dated coins for 25 1933 double eagles or thereabouts and somehow got them out of the building.
Wow.
So the Secret Service was very diligent. They discovered at that time 10 that had been traded among various prominent collectors and they were able to seize and recover 9 of them. The 9 coins were returned and melted. But one 1933 double eagle had already left the country, and it was in the hands of King Farouk of Egypt.
Right.
And so, because this was 1944, we were in the middle of World War II, the Suez Canal was fairly important, they were not going to go try to repatriate that particular coin.
That one was gone,
gone at that moment.
Yes.
And the story continues on that, of course, King Farouk was ousted from power in 1952, and his entire coin collection went up for auction in Cairo. On the auction block was a 1933 double eagle. The mint cabled the State Department and said, we would very much like that coin back. The State Department reached out to the Nasser government, who replied, we'll get back to you on that. And they never did. And so for many years, that became the missing 1933 double eagle. And it was a bit of a lore for some period of time. Until 1996. In 1996, a British coin dealer, Stephen Fenton, did business with a gentleman who bought him coins that he might be interested in buying, and apparently presented him with a cache of coins that he claimed had once been owned by King Farouk. Stephen asked the question, allegedly, is there by chance a 1933 double eagle in there?
Mm-hmm.
He said, yes, there is. You want that too? He said, I'll buy the cash.
Please, yes.
Stephen, Mr. Fenton bought the coin and then went looking for a buyer. He, using various channels, he found a potential buyer in Texas who might be interested in buying a coin of this nature. Unfortunately, that gentleman knew a little bit about the story and contacted the FBI. The FBI contacted the Secret Service.
Right.
And the Secret Service made arrangements to lure Mr. Fenton into the United States with the coin, where he then they broke into the hotel room where the sale was going to take place, and the coin was confiscated.
Wow.
And Mr. Fenton, unfortunately, didn't go the way you thought.
Yes.
That began a first litigation over these coins.
Right.
Because that coin appears to have been the King Farouk coin. The problem with that litigation was that just 2 months before the sale in New York, where the theft was discovered, took place, King Farouk, his representative, had applied for an export license to take that coin and other gold coins that he had purchased out of the country. In those days, you needed an export license.
This is a saga.
Oh, it is. And because, of course, once again, we were in the middle of the war, it would appear that his license was processed expeditiously through the Treasury Department, and the coin left the country. And so that certainly complicated the situation and was a little bit. And also, the mint was just coming to grips with the mountain of evidence that was in the Secret Service report and the documents that were in the Smithsonian, and it made sense at that time to settle that particular litigation.
Right.
And so the settlement was a very good one for, I think, both parties. Mr. Fenton agreed to return that particular coin to the mint as mint property. The mint agreed to actually issue and monetize that one coin. And we did, and then we sold it at auction for Sotheby's in New York in 2002, and it sold for $7.5 million and 20 for the face value of the coin.
Wow.
And that coin sold. It became the most expensive coin ever sold. And you can visit it today. The anonymous owner has loaned it to the New York Historical Society.
Oh, that's very kind.
Where it is on display in their museum at 72nd and Central Park West. Also, it should have been the end of the story. And yet,
I'm going to have to add in an intermission here.
Oh, please.
It's intermission time, folks. So hurry, hurry, hurry. Step right over to our refreshment center for the most extravagant array of refreshment goodies ever assembled under one roof. Enjoy breathtaking, mouth-watering goodies. Everything from a snack to a delicious full meal. At our refreshment center, you'll find a large variety of goodies to satisfy your hunger, your thirst, or your sweet tooth. So hurry, hurry, hurry. Visit our refreshment center now.
We're almost there, I know. We're almost there. So,
I think Lord of the Rings was quicker than this. I
didn't think it would end this way.
End? No, the journey doesn't end here.
While that sale was going on in New York, a gentleman named Moy Langwood, who was the grandson of Israel Swift, the jeweler,
saw
the story in the New York Times and saw his grandfather's name mentioned, and apparently the family then discovered 10 more 1933 double eagles in a family safe deposit box. That led to 11 years of litigation over those particular 10 coins, where the Mint, of course, claimed those belong to us, they are stolen property. The family disputed that, and it led to eventually a jury trial in 2011, and which the government prevailed in, and 5.5 years of appeals. Fortunately for the government prevailed in that case, and the case was finally ultimately resolved earlier this year. So what we have here in the case are two of those 10 coins, those 10 1933 double eagles that were subject to litigation. There are, of course, 8 more that are secured at Fort Knox.
I just can't believe that actually, that now it makes it amazing seeing them now after the whole journey they've been on. No wonder they're worth so much. I mean, how many employees did you have along that time? Those lawyers you had to pay?
It was, well, we owe a great debt to our good friends at the Department of Justice, the AUSA's office of the Eastern District of Pennsylvania, who just did a yeoman's job of helping us through this litigation. There were many complex legal issues, and it was certainly a long journey. Yeah, but it was an education for all of us. There was also a gentleman named David Tripp, who had written the catalog for the sale back in 2002, who was so fascinated by the double eagles that he spent a year of his life researching them and wrote a book on them. And he was a great aid to the government in helping the government prove its case. So these are, now the question that you didn't ask, but I'll answer, is what are we going to do with these coins?
Yes.
No, these will not have, they will not bear the fate of the nine back in the 1940s. Today the Mint views these particular specimens as national numismatic treasures.
I think so, yeah.
We plan to preserve them and make them available. We wanted to, as soon as possible, release them to here to the AMA. We hope to find an opportunity sooner rather than later to display all of them, all the known 1933 and hopefully maybe in the future we'll find a way to even put them on long-term loans to other collections.
Now we better do the last one.
Yeah, I'll do the, this one is actually fairly quick.
Okay.
This, what you see here, is a 1974 dated D aluminum penny. Now, for those of you who may not know why there would be a penny made of aluminum, back in 1974, the price of copper got extraordinarily high, and the Mint needed to make pennies out of something other than copper.
Of course, yeah.
And an extensive R&D program was developed, and they concluded that aluminum was the best metal to use to make pennies. The project was successful. They found a strip that worked well. They had done all the testing, and they were ready to go with aluminum pennies when Congress stopped the project. What happened is apparently the American Medical Association came forward, and they noted that aluminum does not show up on x-rays very well, and children, unfortunately, have a habit of swallowing pennies.
Yes.
And so it would be dangerous to make pennies out of aluminum. Congress then killed the project. The engineers, for what it's worth, disputed that finding and thought they probably could have found a way to cure it. Nonetheless, it was over, and all of the aluminum specimens that had been produced were melted down save for a handful that still exist.
Right.
But that all took place in Philadelphia. So a couple years ago, this particular specimen surfaced. It is a aluminum penny made of the same strip, so it's authentic, but with a demon in it. Now, that's suspicious. There was nothing in the records of doing any R&D here in Denver. That forced us to go back to the records, to the documents, and to interview many of the people involved in the project, who are all still alive. And what we learned was that in 1974, the project manager, a gentleman named Dr. Alan Goldman, sent 2 pounds of aluminum strip out here to Denver to be blanked, because the blanking press in Denver was a slightly different gauge than the blanking press in Philadelphia.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And we have the letter that accompanied the strip. It was very specific. Blank these and ship them back to Philadelphia. Unfortunately, it would appear that some of the Mint employees who were working at the Denver Mint at the time couldn't help themselves, and as long as they had blanks, they decided to see how it would strike. And this particular specimen was discovered in the possession of the son of the late then deputy superintendent of the Denver Mint. And although he originally had hoped to sell the piece, once he was presented with all the evidence, he surrendered the piece and returned it to the U.S. Mint. Once again, like the Double Eagles, we consider it to be a numismatic treasure, we plan to preserve it and display it and share it with the American people.
So how much money are we looking at right now when we look at all of these coins?
Well, the official answer, of course, is that they have no value because they're
priceless.
They're priceless, and they're property of the federal government.
Okay.
And we're not interested in selling them. That said, I'd be speculating, but when you consider that the one Double Eagle sold for $7.5 million, and there has been quite a bit of interest in these pieces. The popular lore is that you probably have more than $10 million of value in this particular case, if they were to be sold.
Yes.
If they were
Which
to
they
be,
never are, not for
if,
sale.
If they were
not
to
for
be
sale.
Issued.
Okay, excellent. Mm-hmm. Well, that was very interesting. I learned a lot in there. I'm going to have to rewatch this over and over to get those extra points.
That's our pleasure.
Excellent. Thank you very much for having me. Thank you so much.
That's all, folks.